Hi, this is Noel Wirst with TechWell, and I am sitting here with Tim Lister. Tim is going to be speaking at the Better Software Agile Development Conference West on Tuesday, June 4th, giving his session, Getting the Right Requirements the First Time. That's going to be, again, Tuesday, June 4th from 1 to 4:30 p.m. Tim, how are you today?
I'm fine, Noel.
Great. When I was going through and trying to choose who to interview and who I wanted to talk to, I really liked the name of the title and that it kind of lets you know that this can actually be done, that you can actually get the right requirements the first time. And I was kind of curious, as for those kind of like me who didn't know that could actually be done, is this a monumental task in doing, or when you have the right communication and skills and tools, is it really not that difficult?
It can be done. I wouldn't bet on it.
Right. Okay.
But what I'm applying in there is, it really is worth trying to do.
Yeah.
Trying to get them right. The cleaner the requirements, the happier the project, is the way I look at it.
Definitely.
Right? To give the chance for the stakeholders to really think about what they want and need.
Mm-hmm. And then I noticed, too, in the abstract, how you kind of group together, you know, the customers, the users, and the business. And then on the other side, you have the developers and the testers in another group, and you explain how bridging that gap is really what makes this all work. And it seems like that's the kind of the core of Agile anyway, is bringing all those people together and not leaving any one of those groups outside of the undertaking. So I was kind of curious, as far as with Agile so definitely welcoming of changing requirements and anticipating them and almost encouraging them, as far as striving to get them right the first time, is there any conflict there at all, or does it all come together fine?
I guess it depends on which flavor of Agile you're using.
Yeah, that's true.
There is a bit of a conflict here, and I must admit that I've got a problem with the burden being placed on the customers, on the stakeholders,
mm-hmm.
to define exactly what they want and need. This is like, to me, self-diagnosis.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I can tell you my symptoms, but I don't need to tell my doctor the disease nor the medication I need.
Yeah, right? That's true.
There's a reason why the doctor is there.
Right. Right?
And to we system builders, it puts a huge responsibility on the stakeholders that I don't think that they necessarily are up to. I mean, it really is saying, oh, you said you wanted this, and now you change your mind. That's okay. It's okay.
Yeah.
Everything's okay.
Right.
We'll do this. You know, it's kind of, you know, you're steering the ship. Oh, we hit a shoal. That's okay.
Yeah.
I got a problem with that.
Yeah.
We need to be partners, not order takers. And to the extent that the Agile community thinks that the customers have these well-formed ideas of exactly what they want and need, I don't know. That's not my experience. I think that's highly naive. And not very productive.
Right. I was on a project one time as the customer a couple of years ago, and you know, we thought we knew everything that we wanted, and then when we proposed all that, they kind of, you know, wireframed all that for us, but they had also kind of added in some other things that we didn't really ask for, but it ended up being things we actually wanted. And so it was almost like they brought back, well, we could also do this and this and this, and then we were like, oh wow, we didn't even think of that stuff. But when we agreed to doing all of that, it caused all these other problems where we lost some of the things that we first wanted and we forgot some things, and it just created a huge mess. So it was kind of like we didn't know everything we wanted up front, but it was almost like the developers introduced some changes for us that we actually kind of wanted, which kind of leads me to what I was going at next, in that if it can't all be placed on the shoulders of the stakeholders and the users, what responsibility do the developers have to kind of get all this done right? If you can't blame just the users, what responsibility do the developers have?
I think they have the responsibility of, I'll call it abstraction.
Okay.
That is, somebody says they want this. What are the underlying requirements and constraints that are there?
Mm-hmm.
And what are the alternative solutions? That could we find a more optimal solution than the one that happens to be in the forefront of the mind of the customer?
Right.
Right. You know, you're speaking about your situation. I have two sons. My older son is an art director at an ad agency in Denver.
Mm-hmm.
And it must have been, I don't know, 5-6 years ago. I said to him, you know, what do you do? Because, yeah, I'm not in this business.
Right.
And he said, well, I'm the graphics part, and the copywriter is the words guy.
Mm-hmm.
So there's the words guy and the graphics guy. And I said, where do you get your ideas? And he said, well, it depends on the situation. We talk with our clients, and they tell us what they want, and then we show them other things.
Nice.
And including things they never asked for.
Right.
And I said, just going along, I said, why do you do that? And he goes, Dad, if we did exactly what they wanted us to do, why are they paying us?
Yeah.
They could just do it in-house.
Yeah. They could just hire someone.
Ideas and concepts that they never thought of, that they might reject completely,
yeah,
or they might embrace. That's our job.
Yeah.
And I thought, wow, maybe that's our job.
Yeah, that's pretty good. I haven't thought about it in that way, but that's true. And the customer kind of, has this vision, but what's to say, not to assume that they're going to be wrong, but for someone that has, developed success and attractive products in the past, they may be eager to come in there with a totally different angle on what they originally wanted.
And I'm convinced that innovation occurs usually outside of the customer sphere.
Yeah.
It's technology. I'm going to forget the name. There's a wonderful book on the history of Bell Laboratories.
Mm-hmm.
John Geithner or something like that, but it, if you go to Amazon and it's Bell Labs and the Great American Age of Innovation or something like
that,
it's a tremendous book, but you realize how the scientists and the engineers at Bell Laboratories formed modern communication. It wasn't the customer saying, we want cell phones.
Right, that's true.
I'm old. I predate cell phones, and I can't remember anybody ever saying, when will they invent a mobile phone for me?
Right, that's true.
And it takes all these technologies to come together where all of a sudden, at a price point with a reasonable availability, all of a sudden, a cell phone, a mobile phone is an extension of your body.
Yeah.
Right? And I look at systems much that way, all kinds of systems where it's our responsibility to offer other kinds of solutions than the one the customer happens to be thinking of,
mm-hmm,
right? And kind of releasing the designers to do great designs.
Yeah.
To really come down with good set of requirements and constraints that gives every degree of freedom to the designers they deserve, no more, no less, is my mantra.
Okay, that's pretty good. So
and so just taking a customer saying, I want this, and saying, right, boss.
Right.
You've missed a moment of truth where you could have said, what are you really trying to do here? What are we trying to accomplish?
Right.
There are other ways of doing this.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just take a minute and talk about this.
Right.
And we, as the analytical side, lead that conversation, not the stakeholders. They elect the choice. We nominate the choices. Put it that way.
As far as, I haven't been on and in those situations where that's kind of where that style of proposal is done. Is there usually much resistance you find from the customers on those kind of things? Or again, is it that's not their expertise and these developers are so good at coming up with these new ideas that the customer is generally, I would say majority of the time, impressed with the idea they never thought of?
Yeah. Some customers, I must admit, there is a kind of customer who doesn't even want to think about requirements. They know the solution. They want this.
Yeah.
Go build it.
Right.
They didn't even want to discuss it.
Yeah.
Right? Other ones you can sneak up on and say, I've been thinking about this. How about this? As you said, things that pop up that they put in the wireframe that you never even thought about.
Yeah.
They just put it in there to see how you react.
Yeah.
You might reject it. You might embrace it or somewhere in the middle.
Yeah.
And so I think that's a critical step because a lot of stakeholders – do their work. They don't. They don't think about their work.
Yeah.
The way we do.
Right.
I've been traveling a whole lot, and one of my travels, I've been going to Stuttgart in Germany a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And there's this little hotel right near the office I work in Stuttgart, and it's a nice, plain little German hotel. And I stay there because I can walk over there. And
right.
Every time I go, I usually get in on a Sunday afternoon. I fly overnight from New York, and it's the same woman who checks me in, a young woman, and she's very, she recognizes me now.
Yeah.
And all that. And one of the things she does is she says, I need your passport. She makes a photocopy of the picture page. So after a couple of times, I said, why are you doing this? And she goes, I'm not sure. The German government makes us, if you're not a member of the EU or a German citizen, we have to take a picture of your picture page on a passport and hold it for the government.
Mm-hmm.
I said, why? And she goes, I don't know.
Right.
That was a perfect example.
Yeah.
They do it. They don't know why.
Yeah.
I was going to say, you know, I've already scanned my passport.
Yeah.
If I gave you a JPEG of my scan, keep it on file, you wouldn't have to make a photocopy every time I show up.
Right.
Yeah. But, you know, they just do their work.
Yeah.
And so I don't know why we do this, but we have to do this.
Right. So that communication that's required then to explain these, you know, new ideas that had not previously been thought of, or to get all the requirements right the first time, you know, and then, like, not necessarily just that initial first talk, but I was going to say, obviously you've got, you know, some sides on the developing side, and like you said, the customer side as well, who don't want the constant meetings and the constant communication. Is that required to get them right the first time, or can the work actually begin pretty soon after this process of trying to get them right the first time, very early on in the process?
I'm a big fan of incremental development. There's no reason why we can't do requirements to buildable, testable scale for some of the requirements and get going while we're doing other requirements. The other thing I'm a big fan of is not having full contact with all the stakeholders all the time.
Yeah.
What I find in my consulting and my work, the really important thing is to have the stakeholders hear each other.
Mm.
To have groups, not one-on-one meetings, groups.
Yeah.
Where we're talking about one feature, let's say.
Right.
For lack of a better term, I'll use the feature. And have all the stakeholders who care about that feature in the room together because they have different perspectives.
Right.
Right. And one stakeholder wants to be optimized for their group, and it's going to cause a whole extra work for some other group. I want the other group in that meeting going, wait a minute,
yeah,
you're going to kill us.
Yeah.
Right? And that the analytical role is kind of facilitating the discussion, focusing the discussion on this piece of the requirements.
Mm-hmm.
And we do it together, you know, whether it's through, you know, Skype or face-to-face or whatever. But we're all there together. So we have these bursts of kind of work sessions.
Right. Yeah, go ahead.
And the analytical role can go and actually do the detailed work of the spec.
Mm-hmm.
And talk to the designers, developers, etc. But I am a big fan of kind of pulling people together to hear each other.
Right.
It makes it also much more interesting for the stakeholders,
because
mm-hmm. often they don't even really think about the other people in the organization. Now there's somebody from audit or something, and they're going, no, we got to do this, and they're going, oh, I never thought about that.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, it starts to make. It makes compromise easier,
right?
In terms of saying, "Look, you don't get it your way because it's going to cause problems over here,"
right?
And most people are reasonable. Go, I see it. We'll de-optimize it for me. It's okay, but over the whole system, it's optimal.
Yeah,
that kind of thing. Whereas if you talk to each person one-on-one, it becomes, "I told you 2 weeks ago I wanted this. Now you're coming back and saying we can't do it that way.
Right.
What's going on?"
Yeah,
it's like, "Oh, you're changing your mind." Whereas I want that all happening in a meeting that lasts, you know, 45 minutes.
Right. Yeah, those meetings that I was a part of with that other software project I was talking about, I wasn't involved in some of the early ones. And so management would kind of come back to me and tell me all these things they discussed. And it was like I was saying, I don't know that that's something we need. Or that's I would have said this or I would have said that. When they invited me in, not only did I get to give my opinion, but I also got to go back to the people who were then kind of below me and say, look, that thing that we wanted, it's going to cost like $60,000, and there's just not room for that one little, you know, that one capability we want to be able to do with this project. And it was like everyone understood. It wasn't just – it didn't come across like, oh, they just didn't take my idea. I was able to kind of get some of the reasons why this would work but why this wouldn't, which was great.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I was going to say lastly, just kind of wrap things up, when I was reading your bio, I saw where it said you have 26 years of experience arbitrating disputes involving software and software services, and it immediately made me wonder if the reason you give this presentation and feel the way that you do is because in these disputes you've seen that a lot of this maybe could have been solved with either clearer communication or more parties involved or just a better effort at nailing this stuff early on instead of letting it these things pop up later on in the project and cause all these disputes and problems.
Yep.
Yeah? That's it.
Great. I've been working with the American Arbitration Association.
Uh-huh.
I'm an arbitrator, and very much a part-time job. And the disputes are amazing, you know, where you look at them and it's all the way down to litigation.
Yeah.
It's so bad you're in litigation, you're having a neutral decide the fate. You can't even agree on how to get out of this mess.
Right.
And often it's just fundamental missed expectations.
Yeah.
Again,
right? Yeah.
Where one party has a completely different view of the world than the other,
mm-hmm.
and they didn't even really recognize it until all. And usually, it doesn't happen early.
Yeah.
If it happens early, it never gets to me. It blows up on delivery.
Yeah.
It usually is. You know, they deliver and the price says we can't accept this, and then you know, then the contractor says we build it to the requirements you signed off on.
Yeah.
Say, but it is not what we need, and then off we go.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's real fundamental blocking and tackling.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, really, it's amazing to, you know, people look at me sometimes and I say, okay, you know, we're at the very beginning of a project. As a consultant, I say, why are you investing all this money?
Yeah.
Describe the future state you want for this money. And it's funny because people kind of go, hamana, often. And you're going, we got to talk about this.
Yeah.
What are the outcomes we need here? We expect, and let's you know, and maybe people in this room have different expectations of the outcomes.
Yeah,
we gotta hammer that out right now. We can't wait and see what appears and blame it on the developers.
Yeah,
if we don't even have a clear view of why this investment is occurring, come on, guys.
Yeah,
it's not time. You know, let's not start the project.
Right.
And some of the arbitrations. But let me put it this way: a pox on both their houses. are almost. I never say never. Almost always, both parties fail.
Yeah.
It's not like good guys versus bad guys.
Right. Never,
in my opinion. Both parties blew their chances to deal with the miscommunication, to correct.
Right.
And they didn't until literally there's a huge investment made. There's a lot of money on the table.
Yeah.
Now people start to point.
Right.
And it's put it this way, I really enjoy doing arbitration, but if I didn't have consulting with healthy clients, it would drive me nuts.
Yeah, I'm sure it's nice to actually see some projects that actually do work.
Yes.
Yeah.
Where people have a party at the end.
Right, exactly. Exactly.
Thanks, guys.
You know, awesome. Really. Cool. Well, thank you so much. That session sounds fantastic. I'm definitely going to check it out. It's going to, again, be on Tuesday, June 4th. It's just next week. It's the getting the right requirements the first time, and that is going to be at the Agile Development Conference, Better Software West in Las Vegas, Nevada, Tuesday, June 4th from 1 p.m. to 4:30 p.m. Thanks so much again.
See you at Caesar's Palace.
I'll see you there.
Right. Bye-bye.